And Mayor, what are you seeing once Metro Manila downgrades to alert level 2?
Well, Karen, at this point, we're already prepared because I was thinking that after Undas, magkakaroon na po tayo ng downgrade. In fact, no, kaya nagawa na nga namin yung mga guidelines namin, nakausap na nga namin yung mga stakeholders namin. Medyo na paghandaan na po namin ito. No? So pagdating ng totoong downgrade, and I'm assuming this will happen after the 14th, more or less, we've already communicated with our stakeholders the necessary protocols that they have to maintain. And we've already sent our various teams like the building official, the BPLD, to check with regards to the closed establishments, like let's say the bars or the, they say videokas will be allowed, to check whether the buildings can be or should be retrofitted to improve on their ventilation. And we've done the same for our movie theaters already. So I think, Karen, more or less, we are prepared for a downgrade here in Quezon City.
Okay, we've seen Davao City already drop the use of face shields. What is the stand of Quezon City on face shield use?
Actually, dito naman, Karen, no, meron kaming ordinansa. Ngunit yung ordinansa namin was really just mandating face shield use in confined and crowded places to begin with. No, never naman namin ito minandato sa mga open spaces. Ginawa lang po natin ito dahil inutos po ito ng IATF sa atin, pero hindi natin ito ginawang ordinansa. Kung kaya't ngayon na ginagawa na ito ng ibang mga lungsod, I believe that this is the right thing to do. Napakahirap din talaga sapagkat napansin din natin na most people tend to wear their face shields on their foreheads as a headband.
That's so true.
They never actually wear the face shield. And so it doesn't actually work for the purpose at which it serves. It is just there for compliance. And if that is the case, then we might as well do away with it and just stress on wearing face masks.
Oh, so ang tanong ko dito, halimbawa pumasok po sa SM Quezon City, sa Trinoma. Pag ganun po ba, kasi usually ang malls, if you don't have face shields, hindi ka papapasukin.
Well, doon sa ordinansa naman po natin, Karen, kasi kasama talaga yung closed spaces, no? So pagpasok mo sa mall, kung enclosed yung mall, wala siyang garden space, nandun ka sa closed part, kailangan naka-face shield ka, batay doon sa ordinansa natin. No? Because yung 3Cs, kailangan pa rin natin i-observe. And that was also the purpose of the face shield ordinance that we passed. It's really to protect our people doon sa crowded, confined, and close contact settings, no? Uh-oh. Pero paglabas nila doon sa garden part ng mall, yung alfresco dining area, tingin ko dapat hindi na nila susuotin yung kanilang face shield. O kaya kahit nasa park area sila, huwag na silang mag-face shield. No?
Oo. Okay. All right. Now, are you opening up more public areas? Let's talk about, of course, minors are expected to go out more this holiday season with their parents or their guardians.
Actually, Karen, medyo pasaway nga kami dito sa Quezon City because under Alert Level 3, minors are not allowed out. But there is also some kind of a contradiction there kasi sinasabing allowed out ang minor to exercise. Pero dito kasi sa lungsod Quezon, marami kasing mahihirap na mga kabataan dito. Wala naman silang mga subdivisions at parks na pwedeng tumakbo, maglaro, etc. Very congested and minsan nga nakakatakot pa na nasa loob sila kulob sa kanilang mga maliliit na tahanan. No? So we opened the Quezon Memorial Park solely for children to be able to run around and exercise and for joggers kasi it is actually an exercise park. So that is one thing that we did. But we piloted that, no? During the weekend, medyo dumami yung tao. Actually, yung capacity is 80% for alfresco. Eh. Kasi yung 50% for alfresco plus 20% kung 70% of your population is fully vaccinated. Tapos kung may safety seal, may additional 10%. Hindi naman namin nilagpasan itong 80%. Pero napansin namin na may mga areas of convergence. Halimbawa kapag may pagkain, dumadami yung tao. And I think that was a very good pilot that we did, no? Kasi dahil dyan, na-observe namin na kulang pa yung mga protocols for open spaces and now we have added more protocols for open spaces and now we are ready to open all our public parks come the lifting or the downgrading to alert level 2.
Yeah, that's good. So right now it's only Quezon City Memorial Circle. How many more public parks will we be seeing this coming alert level 2? Ilan ba?
Well, Sa alert level 2, yung Ninoy Aquino Parks and Wildlife, which is under the DNR, pumayag na rin sila, gusto na rin nilang magbukas. I think yung La Mesa Eco Park, which is also very big, bubukas na rin sila.
That's
very big. Oh, maganda yun talaga. And that's on the other side of Quezon City, the Novaliches side, so we can also serve that population. And of course, many of our barangays have community parks. And what we will do is we'll just make sure na may public safety officer sa bawat community park para magbantay, para hindi naman din adagsaan ng mga bata. Siguro pwedeng on an hourly basis, a set of children will come and play with their guardians kung masyado silang bata. Then after another hour, another set will play. So kailangan lang yung capacity ma-maintain lang natin para yung safety ng mga bata, lalo na't hindi sila bakunado, ay ma-maintain natin. But at the same time, kasi Karen, I'm very strong on this advocacy na kailangan yung mga bata payagan ng lumabas kasi tumaas talaga ang bilang ng mental health cases namin dito. And this month is Children's Month, really. And one of the issues that we have to contend with now is tumaas talaga yung mga batang nagkaroon ng depression, anxiety at stress, no? And that's one reason why one of the things we are doing in the Quezon City government is hiring guidance counselors per school. Sure. Kasi imagine, no, there are only 20 guidance counselors out of about 150 schools or so here in Quezon City. Yung mga bata, wala silang malapitan makausap kasi pati mga nanay nila meron na rin mental anxiety, mental disorders, no? So this is something I want to address, no, which was an offshoot or a consequence of the pandemic.
Wait, this is very interesting and alarming. Do you have the numbers, Mayor? Nung sinabi mo tumaas ang bilang ng may mental health issues, meron po kayong bilang and from what schools?
Well, Karen, at the moment, I don't have exact numbers. At some point, maybe we can do another story on just that, the effects of the pandemic on our people. But I also do know that tumaas ang bilang ng domestic violence sa atin pong mga tahanan by 66%. Ito naman ang datos na binigay ng Quezon City Police District sa amin. No? So again, another consequence of the lockdowns. And this is something also that we are trying to address as advocates for women's rights here in Quezon City.
Okay, now when it comes to the vaccination target of Quezon City, nasa na po ba kayo, ma'am?
So sa vaccination targets, Karen, meron akong good news. So actually, naabot na namin yung target natin na 1.7 million, which is 80% of our adult population. No? And now, actually, umabot na nga tayo ng 1.9 million doon sa may first doses na. No? So that's actually already 110% of our target. And that's 90% of our adult population. So medyo sa adult population, wala tayong problema. Ngayon, nagsisimula na tayo sa ating pong mga kabataan. And we have about 240,000 12 to 17-year-olds that we have to vaccinate. And kung matapos natin ito, maabot na natin yung tinatawag natin herd immunity or 70% of the entire population. No? So we're looking towards vaccinating about 14,000 children a day. And we hope to finish by the end of the month. So hopefully with the proper supplies from the national government, ay matapos na natin itong mga kabataan natin by the end of November.
But you already have the supplies? You already have the vaccines?
Not for the entire month, no, just for a couple of days. Yeah. So hopefully, but they have committed naman, Karen.
Okay. And for minors, I wanted to ask you, anong estilo po sa Quezon City pag minors? Pwede walk in okay ba? Or they still have to register? There's a QR code and the parents receive a text? Or because of the socio-economic profile in Quezon City, may iba kayong approach?
Ay, lagi naman lahat ng approach ginagawa natin dito, Karen, ano? Kasi talagang iba-iba talaga ang mga demographic profiles natin dito. Yeah. Pero at the moment, ang ginagawa natin is we have a booking system, an online booking system wherein they can actually book the time and the date already. At I understand it's very easy. Within 30 minutes, nabubook na. No? Pero kailangan may parental consent. At kapag yung bata ay may comorbidity, kailangan meron siyang medical certificate. Ngayon, yung mga batang may comorbidity, sa hospitals po natin sila binabakunahan. Yung walang comorbidity sa mga paaralan, sa parishes, sa covered courts ng mga barangay, o kaya pati sa Araneta Coliseum, yung pinahiram po sa atin. No? And as we go on and we notice that less and less are being vaccinated using these traditional means, we will now bring the vaccination to the communities as what we have done with the adult population.
So a clarification, whether my comorbidity or walang comorbidity, basta kabataan gusto na magpabakuna sa Quezon City, babakunahan nyo?
Yes, babakunahan po namin. And also I'd like to add, isa rin sa magandang source of data is yung mga paaralan natin, no? Because rather than have everyone book online wherein you know that not everyone has that capability, we also got the master list from our various public schools as well as private schools. And we are also very grateful to the private schools because they have offered to use their premises as vaccination sites, no? So we are going to exhaust all means to be able to vaccinate this pediatric group at the soonest possible time and achieve herd immunity as well. Because kami naman sa Quezon City, we're also believers na kailangan magsimula na rin ng face-to-face classes dahil we are one of two countries that are not doing it. And tingin ko, yung online, no matter how nice your gadget, hindi talaga katumbas ng kaharap mo yung guro mo sa pagtuturo.
Oo. So, tama ka dun eh, Mayor. And actually, I read this morning, I don't know if the report's gotten to you, that a student died trying to retrieve her laptop from their burning home in Novaliches. Nakaabot na po yun, Mayor?
I know that there were fires in two sites in Novaliches, two to three sites in Novaliches just yesterday. But then I didn't know that a student died. Hindi umabot sa akin na umabot yun. No? But that's very, very sad. That's very tragic to hear. Pero nakakalungkot nga yun kasi kami sa Quezon City, we do provide laptops and tablets to our students to be able for them to continue their education. But I've noticed that many children are unable to adjust to online learning talaga. And talagang ako ay advocate for face-to-face classes at the soonest possible time, provided that safe ang mga bata pagpasok nila sa paaralan.
Oo. Meron na ba kayong, for example, a pilot school in Quezon City that you would want, at least to be the first to do face-to-face?
Meron na kami si the MET as per the Department of Education sa memorandum. Okay. We submitted two schools and we're hoping that at least one will be approved as a pilot school for this.
Okay. Would you remember the schools, Mayor?
Yes, I think one is in Payatas and the other one is in Barangay Bago Silangan. And it's really because these schools are near where the children live. The children do not have to ride public transportation to get to schools. So we chose the schools that are easiest for the children to get to without having to risk their safety.
Okay, I'm curious, is there any kind of vaccine hesitancy? We're seeing that outside Metro Manila, there is vaccine hesitancy. There are fears of expiring vaccines. Are you experiencing this, Kahit, in the lower demographics in Quezon City?
At the moment here, Karen, not so much. I actually do not feel that vaccine hesitancy that the people in the provinces have been talking about. Actually, in fact, when we had the surge Delta, ang daming gustong magpabakuna. No? So the problem is not so much that they're hesitant, but how to bring the vaccines to them because of the size of our city and also because there are many depressed communities. No? Minsan napakahirap talaga para sa mga mahihirap nating kababayan na makapunta sa isang vaccination site. Kung kaya't we adopted a new process whereby kami na po ang pumupunta kapag nakakita kami ng mga clustered cases of unvaccinated people in a depressed community, our health workers go to these communities and vaccinate the people. But with regards to hesitancy, I'm not really experiencing any of that here in Quezon City at the level that other LGUs are experiencing.
Okay, Mayor, what are the rules in Quezon City when it comes to vaccine mandates at malls? Vaccination cards are being required upon entry, for example, at certain stores. There's one big home store in Visayas Avenue that requires vaccination cards. And actually, there are malls that require it. Ano ba ang rule? Anong mandato sa QC? Dapat ba may vaccination card?
Ganito po, Karen, ano? Of course, we're following the rules of the IATF in terms of the dine-in. So sa dine-in, pag enclosed, kailangan ng fully vaccinated yung mga customers. Pag alfresco, pwedeng unvaccinated and vaccinated. So yun, sinusundan talaga natin. Pero alam din natin na ayon dun sa mga patakaran ng IATF, pwede naman pumasok ang mga unvaccinated sa mga service-oriented establishments, lalong-lalo na kung these are giving essential goods and services. No? Pero ang ginawa namin sa Quezon City, gusto kasi namin mabakunahan lahat. We require you to tell the guard in the front of the gate or in the door kung bakunado kayo or hindi. So you show your card, but it's not to prevent you from entering. It's just so that we will know kung bakunado ka o hindi. Kung hindi ka bakunado, ililist down yung pangalan mo at yung barangay mo at address mo or contact details kasi tatawagan ka namin. Susumitin ng mall sa amin, sa local government, and then we will call you for scheduling for vaccination. So yan ang purpose. So gusto ko lang linawin yan, Karen, ano, kasi yung ibang mga malls, paulit-ulit na po namin sinasabi sa kanila, hindi niyo po pwedeng hindi pa pilutin ang unvaccinated pumasok. But we would like everybody willing to be vaccinated to be given that opportunity. Kaya please take down their names, get their addresses so that we can schedule them. Yan lang naman po ang layunin nun, Karen. But no prohibition on the part of the local government for unvaccinated people to enter malls.
Okay, so that's a clarification because I don't want to name the city center in Visayas Avenue. But apparently this viewer claims that they're requiring vaccination cards. And if you don't have one, hindi ka makapasok doon sa, I mean, it's a retail area. So bawal yon. Bawal yon.
Yes, bawal yon. Kailangan pwede silang pumasok sa mall because wala naman yun sa patakaran ng IATF na hindi sila pwedeng pumasok. Ang talaga maliwanag lang is yung dine-in. No? Pero kung meron pagkakamali sa pag-unawa ng mall management, please correct them, Karen, through your show and I'll give the correct protocols. And also, please report this mall to us. No? Kasi ngayon na nagluluwag din tayo, Karen, at given the size of our city and given the limitations in enforcement power and our capabilities to make sure that everybody is following. We are depending a lot on the population, the general population, to report to us also when there are issues that they are not clear about or if they want to report violations. And the hotline that they have to call is hotline 122. That is a very easy number to remember. Okay. Tumawag lang sila at magsumbong para alam namin kung ano dapat namin gawin. Opo.
Okay, hotline 122 sa Quezon City. All right, yes. Let's talk about jobs. Let's talk about wage relief. So far, I mean, we are closing into the second year of the pandemic. How many in Quezon City? First of all, let's talk about MSMEs. What has the city done to support MSMEs? And how many have needed some kind of relief from the city?
Well, the number of establishments needing relief, I think, is a great number, tremendous number. No? So what the city has done is last year we passed a supplemental budget of about 700 million to provide wage relief subsidies to businesses, especially the micro and small businesses. So if they apply for this and are given or granted this wage relief program, batay doon sa mga patakaran, kailangan hindi nila itanggalin sa trabaho yung mga empleyado nila. Bigyan namin sila ng tulong para magbayad ng sweldo ng kanilang mga empleyado para lang tuloy-tuloy lang ang negosyo. No? So it's supposed to keep the economy running. And that's phase one was done last year. We're doing phase two now. No? But in addition to that, we've added another budget for micro entrepreneurs whose businesses closed down or who need additional capital or who need to rejuvenate their businesses. So they can apply and they can be given as much as 20,000 pesos, provided that they have a business idea, provided that there is some proof from their barangay that they are indeed a displaced worker or they have a business that closed or whatever, to prove lang na sila ay seryoso naman na magsisimula ng negosyo. Because ngayon, Karen, nasa panahon na tayo ng recovery . Wala na tayo sa panahon ng pagbibigay lamang ng ayuda. No? Kasi yung mga tao pinapahintulutan naman magtrabaho. So kailangan natin silang suportahan. Pero siguraduhin din natin na yung bibigyan natin ng suporta, yung talagang kaya nilang i-sustain ang kanilang mga negosyo. At meron talaga silang initiative to start their own businesses and to start something different. No? And we're there to support.
I'm curious, with the wage relief, for example, Mayor Joy, so let's say I'm a small business and I have 10 employees. Kahit hindi ito residente ng QC. Alam mo yon, marami naman pwedeng galing sa ibang lugar pero nagtatrabaho sa QC. Magkano ang binigay po ninyo sa MSME na yon?
Dako, Karen, depende kasi doon sa una, gusto ko lang banggitin na yung business na kailangan mag-apply, kailangan business in good standing. So kung nalaman namin hindi pala nagbabayad ng tamang buwis, hindi pa compliant doon sa mga requirements ng city, hindi rin sila namin papayagan na makatanggap ng beneficium ganito. No? And that's why I always tell businessmen, there's a time that you will need the city to help you. So sana always be a business in good standing. No? Mm-hmm. And this is one such time. So then we evaluate ilan ba yung kanilang mga negosyo, magkano ba yung buwis na binabayad nila sa city, ano ba yung mga contribution nila sa ekonomiya ng city. Tapos, there is a certain formula that I'm afraid I cannot memorize at the moment, but there's a certain formula that we apply para malaman kung magkano ang ibibigay namin tulong sa negosyong ito para pwede nila ipagpatuloy ang kanilang negosyo at wala silang tatanggalin sa kanilang mga empleyado. No? So that is one program only. And then yung phase 2 naman ito, meron din kaming direct grant din. No? So hindi siya wage relief per se, pero direct grant lang based on how much you pay the city. We will make a calculation and we will give you a direct grant to be able for you to sustain your business. So that's another type of assistance we are giving as well to our business sector. And as well as all of the other ordinances that have been passed by our city council, which is to waive penalties or to postpone payment of business taxes. Lahat naman yan ginagawa ng Lungsod Quezon para makatulong.
I'm curious, also Mayor, with the increasing prices of oil, you have many jeepney drivers, PUV operators that are already appealing for an increased rate, no? And they're suffering. Is the city doing something on its own? I mean, clearly the national government, there are calls na ibalik ang pantawid pasada. Pero with the city, ano po, may ginagawa po ang city ba for your jeepney drivers?
Well, first, the jeepney drivers are not under the jurisdiction of the local government. Only the tricycle drivers are under the jurisdiction of the local government. At I would like to say that yung TODA naman, kapag meron silang apela sa local government, agad-agad din natin ito kinikilusan. Eh. We file the necessary legislation, we do the necessary public consultations, at kung wala namang violent objections, we grant the requests of the TODAs given the situation that they're in at the moment. And in fact, marami din tayong mga TODAng tinutulungan kasi alam naman natin na may problema pa rin sila sa pinagkakitaan nila. So the TODA, some of them we have hired to distribute the modules of our school children sa mga schools. Yung iba naman, tinulungan na natin makipag-ugnayan sa iba't ibang private delivery services, no? So they are now employed by these services at least on a part-time basis. So, and some of them have been hired to do other things na kinakailangan ng lungsod pag kailangan namin ng manpower. We also hire our TODAs to help out. So there are many ways we're helping aside from just with regards to the you know, the fares. But we have increased. I think, if I'm not mistaken, nung time na ni-request nila na kung pwede dalawa yung pasahero, we granted that to them, given certain health protocols and the like. So we're very, we work very closely with our TODA. We make sure that they're okay. That's a big sector here in the city.
Sa food security, Quezon City just recently won a Galing Pook Award for urban farming. Ito yung Grow QC project. I think it's good news that other LGUs need to hear. Okay, so let's talk about that. How many residents is Grow QC servicing, and how do you operate the urban farming in QC?
Well, in terms of the number of residents, it's very, very hard to say, no, Karen, because we have farmers and they've been organized into cooperatives. And we've actually formed the very first urban farming cooperative in the country. No, because I think we are one of the only highly urbanized cities that really have taken urban farming very, very seriously. But then we have very big farms, as big as 10 hectares, no, operated by about 100 farmers, siguro. Then we have smaller ones.
That? I'm really curious, where is the 10 hectares? It's not in QC anymore.
It is in QC actually, Karen. Sa laki ng lungsod natin. But like I mentioned, the demographic profile is so, so different. It's such a heterogeneous city. So we have parts of our city that are agricultural still. No, in their makeup, their cows, they're planting rice, you know, they have all kinds of agricultural activity. And that's one of the another topic for discussion because that was a problem when we had ASF. Ayon sa HLURB, ang agriculture highly urban, and that's something we're trying to work out with kung ano yung balance dyan, no? But that's another story. Ito namang 10 hectare farm natin nasa Barangay Bagong Silangan. We have about 5 hectare farms as well. We have smaller farms. We have a total of about 300 farms, in fact, in Quezon City. And so it's very difficult to say how many are benefiting because some of this produce goes to the farmers. Some are being sold in the market. Some naman we buy as a city for our own feeding programs for our wasted and malnourished children. So maraming nakikinabang dito. But ang importante kasi dito, Karen, is that napansin namin noong panahon ng pandemya, food thing that was a problem. Then ang mga government units sa pag-procure ng mga delivery tumaas ang mga presyo ng mga delata, hindi naman nutritious ang delata, and I wanted to do something that was more sustainable and something that would help us be more self-reliant, no? And that was, and hence the birth of Grow QC.
And I'm curious, just quickly, were you able to measure the success of Grow QC with urban farming?
There are indicators that to measure its success. We have the data pertaining to how much we harvest at any given time. I think we do three harvests a year or something like that. No? But in terms of yung tonelada, yung kilo, ganyan, I cannot tell you the details at the moment. Pero in terms of how successful, I believe that the fact that that the program is able to feed people, that people are able to earn a livelihood because of this program, that the poor during the time of the ECQ and the MECQ, when there was food scarcity, we were able to harvest these vegetables and cook and provide for hundreds of thousands of families for a period of about 10 days, no, during that hard time, shows that this program is worthy of emulating in other local government units. In kind of a probably profile like Quezon City.
Okay, my last question is politics. I think you have three or four opponents running against you, with Congressman Mike Defensor being the most visible one. They say that he would have the support of Iglesia Ni Cristo, and I'm curious, Mayor Joy, how this affects your campaign, or are you still trying to get the support of INC?
Well, Karen, of course, any politician would like to get the support of every group, no? Not just the INC, but everybody, no? Because everybody's vote matters, everybody's support matters. So, that's a fact. If you're telling me they've already made their decision, I have not heard that news.
Oh, no, but, I haven't. I'm just saying, it's not a fact just yet. Okay. It's not a fact yet. It's sources. Yeah.
Then that's fair. That's fair naman, Karen, because every candidate always wants the INC to support them. Then that's fair. If he's trying to do that, I'm also trying to do that. If it's not yet a fact, then both of us, or all four of us actually, because there are other candidates as well that I do not want to discount.
Yeah. Would you consider this the toughest race of your life?
I wouldn't know, Karen, because it hasn't actually really started. You know, in fact, I find it premature, all of this early campaigning, because the actual campaign period is still next year. And there's so much work to do. We're in the middle of the pandemic, and I'm still working on this pandemic. This is still, me, the center of my my leadership at the moment. You know, if I have time, I go and meet the people in the communities. But I am not going to sacrifice my job just because somebody or some people are doing early campaigning. No? I'd like to think that I have a solid performance to back me up for the past 2.5 years that can help me convince the people that it's probably worthwhile for them to still believe in me for the next couple of years.
Yeah, and here's a possible problem for you is with the big voter base of Quezon City. How many registered voters do you have as of now? Is it 1.2 million?
We had about 1.2 million, Karen, in the latest, there must be much more now, no? Because we've had so many new registrants in the last couple of months registering. And also there are a lot of young people in our city that I know have turned 18, because we are one of the youngest cities in this country. I know that's why our average age, I think, is up to.
So my question for you, Mayor, is will you be endorsing a presidential candidate?
Will I endorse a presidential candidate?
Yes.
Well, ganito lang naman yan, Karen. We decided to form our own local party. Dito sa lungsod Quezon, tayo party, SBP, Bisyo para sa Bayan Party. It's because we're obligated to support a government candidate. Lalo sa ako, for myself, napaka-importante na yung pipiliin kong kandidato kasi naniniwala na ako sa pinibigan, sa mga prinsipyo niya, sa karakter niya, sa mga form. Mahirap din na nakatali sa isang local government date dahil nasa government party ka. Kaya dun sa local government party, at least you have that freedom to still exercise your right to choose a candidate that you believe is best. No? So at this stage, we're concentrating on our local party and the members of my party. And we have not endorsing candidate for vice president dito. So, and I think that's applicable to you because my vice mayor is, of course, the son, Vice Mayor Gian Soto. Of respect for my mayor, I'd like to support his. But that is a judicial decision on my part, just off members of if they were to
all right.
him as
well. Okay. All right, Mayor Joy, I don't mean to interrupt you, but just before we go, your internet signal is unstable. But if I understood correctly, you said that with the vice presidency, you personally are already supporting, of course, Senate President Tito Soto, because your vice mayor is, of course, Gian Soto. That's something, is Mayor Joy back? All right, we'll try to get her because that's quite important. Mayor, just before we go, because we lost you, so that there's no misinformation about this, you're saying you are supporting, of course, for Vice President already, Senate President Tito Soto, because of course, your Vice Mayor is Gian Soto.
Me, as a personal yes. choice, yes, I'm going to support Vice President Tito Soto. As out of respect for my vice mayor, Gian, who has been a wonderful vice mayor. So, but again, like I said, this is not official because yeah. We have our own party, but again, the members of the party are free to choose whoever they want to support. But I would hope that they would support the father of the presiding officer of Quezon City.
Okay. When it comes to the presidency, will you do a personal endorsement or support, or would you do it this time, the whole local party?
This is something that we have not yet discussed as a party. At the moment, I cannot answer that question. But for me, Karen, the fact that filing has just happened and the candidates are just about to present their platforms of governance, I would very much like to listen to what everybody has to say first before uh-huh. I make a personal choice and perhaps endorse that particular candidate as well to the rest of my party.
Okay, because clearly Quezon City is a big power base. I mean, I'm sure na liligawan kayo ng lahat ng tumatakbo.
And Karen, I would just like to say I'm very open-minded. Okay. I would like to choose a candidate that is, for me, the best for the country and the best for our city and who has the welfare of the citizens at heart more than personal interest. And definitely no personal interest. Dapat kailangan natin talaga ng isang taong magmamalasakit para sa ating bansa ngayon na kailangan natin bumangon mula sa pandemya. And for me, the beauty of a local party is we have that freedom to choose.
All right. On that note, Quezon City Mayor Joy Belmonte, thank you for joining me today. And good luck to you. And also, you take care.
Thank you very much, Karen. See you again very soon.